Thank you so much for joining into Drew T. Jackson Coaching, Speaking, and Training podcast. Or if you're looking at me right now, then you are on my YouTube channel. And you can find out more about us on drewtjackson.com. And today we got a special guest. This is someone that is very near and dear to my heart. My own brother-in-law, J-Dub, go ahead and say hello to the guest today.
What's up? Hey, everybody. How y'all doing? So glad to be here with you, man.
That is awesome. Hey, well, as you can see, our family get-togethers are a lot of fun. We have a good time together. We're laughing. We're laughing as we come in to the interview today. But I love to interview people that are living their passion, doing what they love to do, are successful at doing it. I love to interview business owners and operators. J-Dub is one of those. And he's also a successful sales rep for a wonderful company here in a nationwide company, worldwide company. My goodness, they're a huge company, right?
That's right.
Yeah. So just success on multiple levels. But what we're interviewing him about today is about breaking Mustangs. Now, just to give you a little background on J-Dub, Jonathan J-Dub Weisiger. So just so you got it down right, but I'm going to refer to him as J-Dub from here on out. J-Dub was born and raised in Fort Worth, Texas here. He loves the Western way of life, bull riding. Am I right? In high school? Oh yeah. Bull riding. And since, 2001 has been breaking wild Mustangs. Now we're going to get into this in a minute. Yes. When I said wild Mustangs, I mean wild ponies that you get out in the wild and then he turns them into pets. Okay. So that's how I interpret it. Okay. He's going to explain it much more clearly, but, he's been an enthusiast of breaking Mustangs, with Extreme Mustang Makeover competition since 2007. And this year you're doing Mustang Magic here in, Dallas, Fort Worth area in Fort Worth, Texas. And you've been doing that for a number of years. Had some placings in previous years, and come on, 2018, this is your year, man.
My year, man.
Come on. Yeah. So anyways, J-Dub, you have done this for a number of years. You love transforming these ponies. Obviously you didn't start, you know, just one day and say, you know, I think I'm just going to go out with a horse and try to break a wild Mustang and turn it into, you know, a domesticated type pet. You know, where did you start? How'd you get from there to here? Tell us about your journey, kind of the bull riding, everything, the whole story, kind of where you're coming from.
Wow, how much time you got?
okay maybe 3 to 5 minutes. Okay, well, let me say that to you.
here's the quick in the Reader's Digest version, if you will. I guess I really got a passion, really was drawn to the Western lifestyle or the Western way of life, all things cowboy and rodeo and cowgirl and bull ride and just everything. When I was 5 years old, my dad took me and my older brother to the very first rodeo I can ever remember. And that was right here in Fort Worth as part of the Fort Worth. And at the time it was the Fort Worth Fat Stock Show in Rodeo. Since it's changed to the Fort Worth Stock Show in Rodeo, but it was for people to bring their livestock or fat, you know, livestock, bulls, cattle, cows, sheep, goats, you name it. They had a big rodeo, and it was just, it's a huge event. And I remember coming and watching the rodeo. My dad brought us to the rodeo, and they had the grand entry and the everything, and it was just like, it was
gotcha.
So cool. Yeah. I was like, I have found my people. I mean, it was great. It was just something that I was really drawn to. And, you know, and I wasn't raised, you know, with a horse in the backyard, the way a lot of people, you know, are, but, that's where I first started. That's where I first got my passion for the Western way of lifestyle. And, you know, we weren't in a place where we could have horses or any of that, but there was an opportunity that I had to work for a ranch. In a little town just south of here in Crowley, Texas, for a couple. Okay. And I got to show some horses, or what were actually ponies. They're called POAs, Pony of the Americas. It's a breed that I got to show. And we go to horse shows here and there, and I got to show and compete and English, Western, raining, just every event that they had at the show, I got to compete in. And that was a great time. I really had a passion for that. But as I grew up, I got into high school and I wanted to start rodeoing. Mm-hmm. And so at high school, I went to Pascal High School right here in Fort Worth. And Pascal, it's kind of in the city. It's not rural. Like, I was the rodeo team. It was me. Like, hey, I'm on the rodeo team right here, team of one. But it was our team was so small, we had to actually join another team to make one combined rodeo team. Okay. So I rode bulls and rodeo and that kind of thing. And it was just something I was drawn to. It was just something that was that I loved. I just went to the rodeo, saw it, loved it, and was like, I've got to do that. I got to be a part of this in some way. So that's where it all started when I was five.
That's where it all started. So you said you started breaking Mustangs, wild Mustangs, in 2011. How did that come about? So you already, at this point, you've already shown ponies, you've done bull riding, you've graduated beyond that and ridden horses for years at this point. But 2001, Mustangs, wild Mustangs kind of appear on the screen for you. What happened there?
Yeah. So in 2007 is the inaugural event of mm-hmm. the Mustang Heritage Foundation has started having these events. It's Extreme Mustang Makeover events. But I had been training Mustangs before that. I had a good buddy of mine, one of the best guys I know, Joe Gray, is really who introduced me to the Mustang. And he, along with another buddy of mine and a friend of his, we would go to their ranch and we would they had been adopting these wild Mustangs. The way it would work is they're and I didn't even realize this. I had no idea. There are about 50,000 wild American Mustangs in either holding facilities or running the rangelands of the western states of America.
Wow.
And we call them wild horses, or really feral horses, which just means they were domesticated and then they were turned loose. They went wild. They reverted back to their... Just turned loose. Horses that can be traced back to the horses that Cortez originally brought here. So they're wild horses, yes, you know, wild Mustangs, but that's really how they're classified as feral horses. But Joe and his buddy...
Learn something new every day.
I know. Hey, there you go. It's something he had been adopting these Mustangs, and they'd been working with him and training him. And I kind of came into the mix, hung up my rodeo spurs, and found my passion for just riding and training horses again. So I started riding. I got a horse. I started working with these Mustangs, started working with Joe and his horses. And we had some success. We trained some horses. We'd ride them. And, you know, it was a good time. There was a bunch at one time. But in 2007, Joe was reading, I remember, in Western Horseman magazine. And he said, J-Dub, there's this event called Mustang Makeover, and it's gonna be here in Fort Worth, and man, they're taking like 50 trainers, and you ought to sign up. I mean, you've been training these Mustangs here, you ought to sign up and do it. And I was like, you doggone right.
So right,
I sent in an application to compete. I got a letter back, said yeah, you're approved. So that's how it started. That's how I was introduced to the Mustang. And in 2007, that was the very first competition, and that was what I went to.
That's very cool. And there are people that come from all over the United States and compete in Dallas-Fort Worth here. Is that correct?
Oh, yeah. Across the nation. I mean, from California to New York State, from Florida to Washington. I mean, crisscross the nation, there are people that compete in these events across the entire nation. There are some events they'll have an Extreme Mustang Makeover in Kentucky, in Fort Worth, in Nevada. Just they have them in a lot of different states. At the Mustang Heritage Foundation produces these events through the Extreme Mustang Makeover organization. But yeah, there it's a national thing for the most part.
Very cool, very cool. Now, what was the turning point in, I just made up a word, in your horsery? I think did you say Mustanging earlier? Did you say that?
No, I didn't.
Oh, okay. I misunderstood you. I thought, okay, that I'll have to add that in. But what was the turning point in breaking these Mustangs when you kind of realized, hey, I'm pretty good at this. And, and there's a moment where you thought, hey, this could be something special. This could be something, you know, that could be really neat, you know, and could kind of define who I am and what I do.
Yeah, no, I mean, from that first event, that inaugural event in 2007, it was a pish-posh. It was professional horse trainers and just backyard people that like horses that each one of them took a wild Mustang and had 100 days to train it. You know, that's kind of the
same. Yeah, thank you for sharing that. If you could, I didn't get that. I didn't ask that question. Tell us, though, that process real quick, if you would.
Yeah.
You get a wild Mustang, and then you have a time slot that you have to – go ahead, share with us. Yeah.
Yeah, you have a set time frame. I mean, it's relatively – when you look at horse training as a whole, 100 to 120 days is a very short time frame to get one broke and running around and roping a cow and just doing all the things that a lot of us do. And but the way the process works is we pick up a wild, untouched, untrained, unhandled – American Mustang, we have 120 days to train that horse to the very best of our ability. And then we bring that horse to the competition and compete. And everybody picks their horse up the same weekend. So nobody gets their horse longer or a little bit extra days. Everyone picks their horse up the same time.
Okay.
It's in a clean slate. Everyone's getting a Mustang. The luck of the draw is just whatever horse you get, you get. You get what you get and you don't throw a fit.
So right.
You have that horse good, bad, or indifferent, that's the horse you're drawing. So we train these horses, and then we get to compete in the event. And that's what we did. We had, in this particular event, the first one, we had 100 days. I mean, we had a little over 3 months to train a horse from wild to able to climb on this thing and ride through an arena and just have and a good using horse.
And do tricks. I mean, not just – this is a show. This isn't just a, you know, hold it by the rope or whatever and walk it around. You're actually performing, getting really creative. You've done some different things over the years, which I want to ask you about in just a minute. Well, let me ask you, what do you think was the craziest kind of thing that you were able to do with your horse in your performance?
You know, I've always had this dream. There's a scene from the movie Lonesome Dove.
Okay.
Where Gus, or, you know, Augustus McCrae, who was a Texas Ranger, and his sidekick, Woodrow F. Cawley, they, you know, if you've seen the movie, you know who they are. And there was a scene where he's being chased by some bandits or whatever they're after him. And he's trying to run. He's trying to outrun him. And he can't get it done. There's nowhere to hide. So he runs and he pulls his horse down on the ground and he lays behind it with his rifle and he just uses his horse for cover and starts shooting and picking off these guys, these bandits as they're coming at him. And I thought, man, to reenact that would be so cool. And so I did.
For a wild horse to be able to lay down and not get spooked and go crazy when you're firing off a gun on it.
Yeah. That I mean, that was it. I was like, man, if a horse would sit there and put up with that, they're going to be pretty quiet. Overall, a horse that's not quiet is going to giddy up, go, see you later, bye.
And yeah.
So that was something I always thought was cool. I was like, man, that'd be great to be able to do that in a competitive environment, you know, putting on a show. But that was that, you know, and to your early point, you know, about when did I feel like, oh man, I've got some ability, or man, maybe I can, you know, turn a hand at this. It was at that first event. It was the first event they ever had.
Mm-hmm.
And going in, there were three areas of competition. There was the handling and conditioning. And that's just how well your horses fit. Are they fed? Are they in good physical condition? Do they lead? Can you pick up their feet and clean them? Are they easy to just handle?
Yeah.
And then there was the trail portion where we kind of go in and do kind of a trail course and jump over some logs and different things. Anyway, after the first, there were three go-arounds. After the first two go-arounds, I was leading it in the average of these 50 trainers by, I think it was about a 10 or 15 point margin.
Wow.
Because I got second in handling and conditioning, and then in the next event, I was second as well. And the people that beat me, you know, got first in each one of those, were way further down in that next one. So from a points perspective, going into that final event, I was like in it to win it. I was like, it was mine to lose. And I was like, man, I was all fired up. I was all excited. I was like, oh man, just, but a ball of nerves. And I remember going in there, and because I went in and I turned the wrong way, and this really taught me a lesson about improving your game and making sure you're always on your game and really focusing on improving yourself. And in this particular case, as a trainer and following the, you know, what the pattern is, what the required maneuvers are. Because I rode in there, and one of the maneuvers was you had to pivot twice to the left and then twice to the right. And I got those in reverse order. My horse did it great. All the maneuvers executed well, but I got them in reverse order, and it got me a great big goose egg. I got a zero, and it dropped me out of the average. I fell so shorty. I just fell short of being in the final. And it was one of those times I was like, oh, but the individual that wound up winning that year is a gentleman by the name of Guy Woods, a National Cutting Horse Association champion. I mean, he's one of the great cutting horse trainers in the world. I remember a guy now that he's one of, in my opinion, one of the best horsemen. It's a guy named Zane Davis, National Ranked Cow Horse Association Futurity champion, and he's done so many things, but he got third in that event, and they're just, they were good. They were horsemen I'd watch and look up to, and learn from. But I was able to run in that particular environment, in that place, given the same amount of time, same amount of days, same, the apples and apples. I was, in my mind, I was like, I was right there. I was right there in the hunt. And I thought, you know what? I feel that I've got the ability to do it.
Yeah.
But like anything, if you just, you know, you can have all the talent in the world, but if you don't really study and work and train towards it, you know, you can have all the talent, but if you don't grow in that area and you don't really try to pull the best and all the potential that you have, you're not gonna get much done. And so that's when I knew, man, maybe I've got some ability to do this.
That is so good. What a heartbreaking, but I love that you were able to take that experience and learn from it and grow from it and get better. And the people that you're competing with are people that full time they're training horses. Maybe not all of them, but a lot of them, many of them are doing this full time, and you're doing this almost as a hobby on the side. I mean, you know, you work for full time. You do have a business that has to do with horseshoeing. So you're working with horses on a regular basis. But still you're doing this in your quote unquote spare time with four daughters, you know, and a marriage and everything together. It's just amazing. But I love what you're talking about with personal development and growing from that. How has personal development and growing, 'cause obviously, you know, that's what I'm into. I'm a personal growth coach, leadership coach. I'm a big proponent of that. How has personal growth, and you were alluding to it in the last question, how has that been a part of your journey and, you know, helped you become the person that you are today?
Yeah. I mean, it's at least in the world of horse training, there's always somebody getting better. There's always somebody younger, quicker, faster, better, working harder, that's right on your tails to compete. And so, as far as training, competing, there's never this point at which you arrive and like, man, I figured it out. I've got the combination. I know. I mean, obviously there's a certain level where, you know, certain things you need to do to accomplish your goal, but to take it to the next level, you've constantly got to be improving. You've got to improve and work towards, is there a better way? Is there a, I mean, if you just are, you know what, I think I'm doing pretty good. I think I got this thing figured out, and you kind of have that sense of I've arrived. I've kind of got it. That is when you get smoked. And somebody that's willing to work harder and really invest and put the time in to improve is going to beat you. It's, you know, you're either by default, if you're not growing personally in your ability and in your skill and your talent, then you're by default, you're going backwards.
Yeah.
You know, if you're not making an effort to grow, because there's the whole wave is moving forward. And so, I mean, I remember seeing kids that were in the youth yearling Mustang event, which is a really cool event that youth can get involved in, that are now, I mean, right, you know, they're over 18 now, so they're able to compete in the normal event or the adult events. And they are, you know, these young whippersnappers that just a couple of years ago were, you know, lead lining their horses are now riding and smoking folks that have been doing it a while. So, growing in your craft and your trade and your ability and really trying to improve on a lot of natural talent you may have is critical if you want to be competitive.
Yeah, that's good. Talent just isn't enough. You can be very talented, but you have to work your craft, whether it's training horses, leading a business, whatever it is, sales, you know, being on a sales team, you've got to continue to work your craft and be disciplined and put in the time and do that. I love that. What a great just overall life lesson right there for anybody listening today. And one thing we didn't mention earlier, if you can tell that J-Dub seems, you know, very comfortable on the other side of a camera, that's because you have also been on television. You were picked up by a television show a couple years back, a reality television show for training Mustangs. There were a few of you that were on this show. Tell us, you know, just real quick about the show and what it was, where it was at, and I think you got some stuff on your website about it.
Yeah, absolutely. It was a Mustang Millionaire, not because I am a millionaire, but because the show was titled that because there was $1 million purse up for grabs. So I was invited myself and five other trainers. Nat Geo Wild is who produced and aired the show. And we were invited to be a part of it. And we thought it would be a really cool thing. And it was a lot of fun. You were able to see and get an understanding of the insights of reality TV, because it was a reality TV show that chronicled our journey from taking a wild Mustang, training it, and then competing on it at the Mustang Millionaire event that was here in Fort Worth. And it was a lot of fun. It was really cool. But a lot of takes over and over and over. It was like, hey, say that again. Great. Okay. And they moved the camera up here. All right. Say the exact same thing all over again. So there was a lot of, I mean, we put in some long days when that was going on, but luckily they weren't filming us every single day. You know, they would come in time frames that we had plenty of notice, but it was a great experience. It was really cool. It was a lot of fun. And with a lot of good friends that were on that show. So yeah, Mustang Millionaire is what it was called. And it was just a fun show, and it really did a good job, I thought, of showcasing what happens in the process of training a wild Mustang. But there was obviously some storyline to it, but it was a good show. It was a lot of fun.
Well, let me ask you this. I was thinking about this as we were talking, and over the years you've trained, you get these wild Mustangs, you're given this Mustang, you spend 120 days with it or 120 days with it. You get to know this horse and its personality. And then you do this event, and then they sell them. And, right. And someone takes home that pony. Do you have a favorite? And then do you have a least favorite over the years? maybe we shouldn't say the least favorite. I don't know. It's someone's pet now somewhere, I guess. But do you have a favorite for sure? I'd love to hear about your favorite, and then you know, maybe why.
Yeah, I mean, probably. I guess in my mind, the one that stood out is my favorite. Or I would qualify this in this way. I was behind the eight ball in the event when I got this horse, because about a week, no, actually the same day I picked up my original mare to compete in Mustang Magic, I noticed she was limping when I worked her around this round pin.
Oh, wow.
Was sliding. It wasn't a big, you know, I didn't think it was, you know, maybe a stone bruise, nothing big. I just thought, you know, maybe she hurt at the trailer on the way. No big deal. We'll give it a few days, see if she, you know, it gets better. And I worked and worked her. Well, over the course of about 4 weeks, it wasn't improving. And I was, you know, I was doing everything I could. I took her to the vet. And it ultimately determined she had an injury, a high suspensory tear, a tear that actually occurred. It's an old injury that she re-injured based on what the vet said. So I had the opportunity to get a redraw. Mind you, I'm 6 weeks at this point behind everybody else.
Wow.
And I went and the BLM, Bureau of Land Management, was hosting an adoption. And Mustang Heritage Foundation called and said, hey, do you have a backup horse for J-Dub? They said, yeah, we've got one worth this event. If he can come down here and pick it up. And I went down and I picked up this Mustang mare, and she was a beautiful paint Mustang mare, and I named her Honey Badger. And I'm 6 weeks behind, but I worked to try to catch up, and I wind up reserve champion on her and rode her bridleless, no neck rope, no nothing. Her
wow.
saddle. That's it. No, there's no emergency brake. There is just, you're hanging it out there. And this mare performed so well. And we did really well. Actually, we wound up getting reserve champion. And then that mare sold for, I think it was $17,500 as you know, 90-day wild Mustang from the wild. And so that she's probably my favorite. The favorite one, just because her trainability, she just took the training so well. And she's one that I she's one I'd love to have. You know, she was a great mare.
Well, let me ask you this. Can you share anything? Is there some secrecy around this year, or can you share like the name of your pony this year or anything like that? Okay. So tell
it's
us.
Big secret.
Yeah. So I know you name them every year. So you had Honey Badger. I know the name of your pony this year. Share about this year. Maybe a couple things that you want to share, what you're working on right now. And yeah.
Yeah. I'm going to tell you. Okay.
Okay. Just me. And the entire internet, okay.
This year, my mare, she's a sorrel mare, a five-year-old mare from Betty's Butte, Oregon, is the range area she comes from. And she is, we named her Orangistang because she's a real dark orange kind of sorrel. And the girls came out, we were looking at her and everything, and they're like, yeah, she's so orange looking. And we got to talking about it, and it just fit. So instead of an orangutan, we named her Orangistang. So
I love it. I love it.
This mare, I will tell you, this mare has been a tough cookie as far as Mustangs go. As many as I've trained, they come in all shapes and sizes. And this mare has been real tough. I wasn't even actually able to get my first ride on her until November 12th. So, which we picked these horses up middle of end of September. So
that'll
give you an idea how long it took to be able to get that first ride. She's been a tough nut to crack, but she's turned a corner and we are well on our way. We're a couple weeks out, about 2.5 weeks from the event. So we still have a little bit of work left to do, but at this point, it's just fine tuning, putting a little spit shine on, a little polish. And then show up and see what you got.
Here we go. Well, hey, tell us how people can connect with you, and maybe social media, website, all that kind of stuff. And yeah, I want people to be able to find you and see what you're up to.
Yeah, absolutely. I've got a website, mustangwrangler.com, and then you can connect with me at themustangwrangler@gmail.com. And yeah, we're going to launch a YouTube channel coming in the spring where we're going to actually showcase some folks working with and training wild Mustangs for the first time. Just their first opportunity to take a wild horse, train it, and just kind of follow their journey. We're gonna post it. We're gonna create a YouTube channel, put them out there, and let people see what it's all about. So I'm excited. We'll do that this spring. We don't have an exact date yet, but we'll just stay tuned to Facebook and social media, and we'll put it out there.
All right, I will put I'll put MustangRangler.com, your social media handles in the show notes, so people can just click on the links there and find you. I want to ask you a couple of rapid fire questions before we go. Does that work for you?
Go.
All right. Rapid fire. Remember, it's rapid fire. Okay. This is what people forget. All right. What was the last thing you watched on TV and why did you choose to watch it?
The last thing, me and the kids just finished watching, a movie called Dreamer. It's about a racehorse. I think it's got Kurt Russell and,
can't go wrong with Kurt Russell, man.
Yeah, you good? Yeah. Dakota Fanning plays the girl in the little character in the thing. It's about a racehorse. So with the girls and I, it's freezing here, so there's nothing to do outside. So we're inside watching the movie.
Exactly. Same here. What were you like in high school, J-Dub?
I was really cool, man. No, actually, I in high school. Wow.
Rapid fire.
yeah, rapid fire. Well, I'll tell you what, I had a hairdo that was pretty crazy. It would probably be normal now, but it was shaved all the way around the sides, but long on the top, and it was crazy wild. And I was in high school, I was believe it or not, I was pretty low key outside of being the only bull rider for our high school. I kind of flew under the radar.
Wow, I mean, that is hard for me to believe. That's hard for me to believe. All right. A six-year-old child asks you if Santa Claus is real.
Oh.
What do you say?
Yes and no. About that one. I say he used to be.
Okay. There you go. What would your pet say about you if we asked for a reference?
So qualify pet. So like, do my horses count as pets? Or
no, we're going to say like dog, cat.
Oh, okay. We got two cats and man, nobody cares what cats say.
That tells you enough right there. That's a good rapid fire answer. All right, last one, and you have some frame of reference with this. Would you rather fight a horse-sized duck or 100 duck-sized horses?
Oh, no. One-on-one. I'll take the one duck. If he's horse-sized, I'm cool.
You got it.
I'll rope that sucker.
Ducks are mean, though, and they can fly.
Hey, yeah.
That's but, like a – anyway. All right. Hey, J-Dub, thank you so much for letting me interview you and believe in the best for this Mustang Magic Competition 2018. And it's going to be an awesome year for you and Orangastang. And so thank you so much. Hey, this is Drew T. Jackson, coaching, speaking, and training podcast and YouTube channel, interviewing people that are living their dreams, being successful, and doing what they love to do. I will talk to you soon. Bye.